Now, first, quantum computers represents the marriage of the two great disciplines of the last century. One is quantum mechanics and the other is digital computers. Nothing has had as big an impact on human civilization as these two technologies. Okay, you can bring in genome and stuff like that, but you know, it's also there. But these are two key areas, quantum mechanics and digital computers. So let us look at what is this quantum computing. A quantum computer is a machine that performs calculations based on the laws of quantum mechanics. And if you don't know what is quantum mechanics, don't panic. Richard Feynman himself has said that hardly anybody understands quantum mechanics. Okay? Even Albert Einstein couldn't reconcile himself to agree to this whole concept of quantum mechanics. And yet, you cannot disagree with it. It is counterintuitive to the extreme. All our thoughts about, you know, you can explain it, you know, it should be, you know, we talk of data science being, it should be explainable and all that, bunk. Okay? It's very difficult to acknowledge things that they work the way they do in quantum mechanics, but yet they do, because that's how the world runs. Now, the point is, quantum computers came out as a concept long ago, in 1982. By the great Feynman himself. Feynman was trying to solve, that time, you know, these our first wave of digital computers had arrived in the market. So we're all jumping about, you know, things like, you know, C program and all of those things. C had just about appeared. So then these guys got running around it. And a guy called David Deutsch, he developed the concept of the quantum Turing machine. Turing machine, we all know. From the world of digital world, we all know Turing machine, okay, AI, stuff like that. But the quantum Turing machine is a strange animal, and we'll see how strange it is in just a few minutes. Okay, then this computer came up, at least in concept, but there were no programs to run on that computer. You know, Richard Feynman's problem, dur ki baat hai, I mean, nobody could even touch it. Okay, conceptually, then two key algorithms appeared. One was the Shor's algorithm, okay, and the other is the Grover's algorithm, and we'll talk about it a little later, okay. All our algorithms in machine learning and data science can get converted to quantum processes. This book virtually talks about it, and this is what triggered my interest in bringing this quantum computers into this. Because, you know, we have heard of, you know, all the algorithms, classification, Bayes, Naive Bayes, this, that, all of them have an equivalence in the world of quantums. And hence, it's going to have a very big impact. More importantly, it's data science and quantum is feeding on each other. To solve the problems of building quantum computers, you need data science techniques. And in return, quantum computers can be used to solve data science problems. So it is a two-way process. You know, the two disciplines are quite entangled with each other. How the physicists use data science is one aspect. How can we as data scientists use quantum computers? And in addition to Shor's algorithm and Grover's algorithm, this particular algorithm... But this is easier to understand. Now what is happening out here? We have 5 qubits which are set to 0 to start with. Now, I can't read the data. To read the data, I have to put in a sensor which will extract it and convert it into a classical bit. So to do that, I normally take this one and I plant it here. Okay, so this will, once the experiment gets over, it will sense the value of this bit and send it to me, which I can print on a, I can see actually, because this data I cannot see. So let us see, you know, what happens if we put two of these out here. I want to read the first two pieces of data. Okay. Now I can do two things. I can actually run this on the actual machine, or I can simulate this run on a classical machine. Eventually, I will run it on the actual machine because running it, you know, costs me some credits. So, you know, I'll show it to you also. But let's see what happens if we simulate a run. We say that we will simulate it 100 shots, which means we'll run the experiment 100 times and I simulate it. This is the answer coming out. What is the answer? Answer says, I sensed a 0, 0, 0 each time, each 100 times I got zeros, which is what we expected to be because we had made no changes. We set everything to 0 and we read a 0. Okay. Now let's make it a little bit more different. On this one, we flip it. So the 0 becomes a 1 out here. Okay. So now if I simulate this, I would notice that the 0, 0, 0, this 1, the first bit has flipped from 0 to 1. So again, that is, this sounds classical. I mean, nothing has changed. I've just changed one bit from 0 to 1 and I'm reading it. Now we will, you guys with me on this, right? What am I doing? I'm just setting a value and then reading it. Nothing could be simpler than this. Now we will bring in the this Hadamard gate. Okay, what it does is it will put it in superimposition, which means 50% time it should be in zeros, 50% time it will be in one. Okay, so now you see what has happened. 50% time it was 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1. So now the output, you know, 50 times I got one output, 50 times I got the other output. Okay. Now let us see something else. We are still simulating it. We are not running the actual beast as yet. We are simulating on a classical computer the behavior of a quantum computer. Okay, now let us see what happens if the same thing we run on the real computer, and this is where the element of uncertainty, it sometimes it runs instantly, sometimes it runs after half an hour, gets queued and all kinds of things. Let us see what happens out here. So it says, yeah, we already ran this once for you in the past. Do you want to see that result or do you want to see a new result? Okay, let us see the old result. I mean, it'll be faster, definitely. This will take a lot of time, okay? Get existing result. You see what happened? Most of the probabilities happened here. We were expecting this, 50-50. But even these probabilities happened. Error. And that is because the lasers didn't fire properly or the temperature got a little bit higher or whatever. So there is errors happened. Okay. In my simulation, there were no errors because it was very clear. Moment I moved to the real computer, real quantum computer, these errors happened. And this is our current problem with quantum computers. They give errors. And, you know, the more and more sophisticated computers, their error levels are going lesser and lesser. So, you know, that is the challenge in building these machines so that they can work with, you know, lower and lower errors. The best computers operate with far lesser errors, but we don't have access to use it. We have access to a fairly old computer, the 5-qubit. It's based on a little older technology, so it has this many errors. So this is the problem of how to use quantum computers. Okay, but this is how you code. Okay, with me on this, how this coding works. Now you will say that this is a what is this? I mean, it is writing and printing numbers. Where is the fun in all this? So now let us see actually an implementation of the Grover's algorithm, what it looks like. Okay. Of gold rather than a stone brick. Okay. This is a classical search and find problem. Now, typically to solve this problem, if it is 4, you can always open 4 doors one by one. If the number is very large, you need approximately n by 2.5 to get the number, to actually get that brick of gold. So if this n becomes very large, million, 10 million, 200 million, you will have to go through 1 million times of opening and closing the doors, okay, before you find that gold brick or whatever you are searching for. Grover's algorithm can do it in one shot, and that is the power of the quantum computer. This algorithm solves the problem in one iteration, whereas any normal our, you know, C, Java iteration, you know, will take a million iterations before it can find this gold brick. That is the power of the quantum computing process. One iteration, it will get this answer out. So if you look very carefully, you first put both qubits in superposition, so all four doors are equal probability. Two qubits, two positions, four doors. Okay, this is how you change, you hide the car behind door 1-1. Don't press me too hard on this, okay, but this is the code which, now in reality, this will be replaced with a quantum database. This is a quantum database with only four pieces of data, of which one data is different from the others. Okay? Now, this will be replaced with a together. Then if we, this is the code which runs, and after the running, you will get the answer. It will always point to the right door which has the golden brick in it. Okay? So this is how you actually write the code. Okay. So this is clear. Do you understand how we write code? And you know, it's very different from our writing of code. I mean, you know, we are used to writing a code in C, compiling it, running it, and all those things. This is also, in a sense, you're not compiling and running it. You are running a physics experiment 1,000 times, looking at the outcome, and then calculating probabilities, and then figuring out what is your correct answer from that, and your entire algorithm has to change to meet this requirements of the superimposition and entanglement and all of these things. Okay, that is not easy. You know, it requires significant effort. So there are efforts happening in two dimensions, two areas. So we have solved this Grover's algorithm problem, and you can read more about this by clicking these links. It will take you to all the references. Honestly, I have not created this particular image. It's taken from somewhere else. So way forward, what are we doing right now? Where are we? Okay. As I said, these machines are real. This machine, we have just seen this machine operation. This machine, this has recently been sold for about $15 million. $15 million is not really a great sum of money in the standards at which we operate. You know, for a big company, it's a reasonable amount of money. So it is not something, far-fetched. You know, it's not something that, not like a Mars rover or something like that. It's much more, closer to us. And of course, Google has a plan to do everything everywhere. They've also tried. So now there are
two types of machines in the market. Okay. IBM has got this machine which we just saw. We saw the 5-qubit version. For their own research purposes, they have a 20-qubit version, which is supposed to be, you know, far more, you know, superior to what we could do out here. But in principle, it's the same thing. Same IDE is there. You know, instead of 5 qubits, it'll have 20 qubits, and the same Hadamard gate, X gate, all of those things can be done with that. So this is it. On the other hand, there is a strange company called D-Wave out of Canada, okay, which talks of a 2,000 qubit machine and another 2,000 qubit machine, okay, and apparently they have sold it to a company which is a security company, because this is very widely used in, as I said, you know, breaking of passwords. Okay, that's why security companies are particularly interested in it. So this company called Temporal Defense has done it. For a lot of time, there was skepticism. This 2,000 qubit machine is, is it a real machine, or is it a machine masquerading as a quantum computer, but perhaps a very fast classical computer? So there was a huge debate. A lot of people said, oh, rubbish, this can't be the truth, and this and that. But ultimately, the consensus today is that it is not gas. Because, you know, Google has installed it in one of their sites, and they have done some. So it is not really something fake or fraud. It is a computer. However, there is one difference. This 5 versus 2,000, how can two companies be at two such different levels? I mean, you know, you see Intel and an AMD chip, they are comparable. They can't be, you know, 1,000th of another. So what is the difference out here? The difference is the IBM machine is a general purpose computer, which means it can, in principle, run any kind of program, starting from addition of two numbers, to Shore, to Grover, to database search, to whatever, all of those things, okay? Now, the D-Wave machine is a very specialist machine. It does a few things. It cannot solve all the problems. It still uses quantum principles, but it solves a one specific class of problem called rule-based optimization. And in the world of data science, this is a very hot topic, okay? And hence, the world of data science has jumped on this one because, you know, it solves an immediate problem for a lot of people. Google's recognition problem, AI problem, ANN problem, that entire class of problems can be handled here. This machine is a more of a general purpose machine. It is used for, you know, lots of other things like protein folding, chemistry, and all of many other things. It's a general purpose computer. One day perhaps we can also run a browser on it someday, not now. But this one is a dedicated machine meant for one thing and does it well. Okay, that is the difference between the huge gap between this 5 and 2000. Okay, it's a special purpose machine. So I think that's we are at the moment. So I'll stop here. A few minutes for questions. This slide deck is available out here. Okay, you can download the slide. You can use it wherever you want. It's Creative Commons. But you would agree with me that this is a totally different way of computing. I mean, you know, as I said, you know, all my 25 years of coding, never come across something called probabilistic like this. Okay? So that's it. And thank you very much. Okay.